I'd like to say I'm privileged and honored to introduce Dr. Nagle, but since I offered to do it, but I am privileged and honored to introduce Dr. Nagle. Robin Nagle is the director of New York University's Draper International Interdisciplinary Master's Program. She's also clinical associate professor of anthropology at New York University. She teaches cultural anthropology. And she's also working on a course on science fiction that she's going to offer next year. I found that out in the car on the way here. For the last 10 years, Dr. Nagle has been anthropologist in residence for the New York Sanitation Department. And if you've never heard that position, there may not be any others. She's also co-founder of the Discard Studies blog. Dr. Nagle's early ethnographic work was in Brazil, and that led to a 1997 monograph. On claiming the virgin, the broken promise of liberation theology in Brazil. In the last several years, in anthropology circles, in journals, in the New York Times, in the magazine Mother Jones, in a C-SPAN interview, and in a TED Talk, Robin has received wide social media and scholarly attention for her field work with New York City sanitation workers. Her 2013 book, Picking Up, which you really ought to pick up, describes the jobs and difficulties of New York City sanitation workers. During her field work, Professor Nagle drove a truck, a street sweeper, which the sanitation workers called a broom, got that right, a snowplow, and she picked up trash cans by hand, all of which gave this anthropologist a new perspective on the phrase participant observation. One of the most lucid and engaging ethnographies of the last 20 years, Robin delves deeply into the working lives of sanitation workers in the city. She describes their stamina, their physical strength, the mental knowledge needed to do the job, the skills, and there are far more of those than people like most of us would realize, and the social relationships and camaraderie that keep so many of them in their profession until their retirement years. In one of dozens of interviews, this one on National Public Radio's Science Friday, Robin was asked why an anthropologist chose to work with sanitation workers, not really our traditional venues. She answered that she wanted to show the public the importance of sand men, as she calls them in her book, to the life and welfare of the city, to demonstrate that their work is as essential to New York City as the work of other uniformed officers like police and fire. To most citizens, their service is stigmatized as well as invisible. She calls them garbage fairies in one place. In fact, most citizens, same in Delaware, I imagine, prefer not to see them at all and often pretend not to, even when they do. For this reader and hopefully thousands of others, Robin makes them, their jobs, their lives, and their humanity quite visible. And making the lives of others, with a capital O, visible, knowable, and human to people like us, with a capital U, has always been a major goal of anthropology. So pleased to have Robin here tonight. Please welcome her.
Thank you, Jim, for an extraordinary introduction. Thank you, Owu, for having me back. I was here in November and was astonished and delighted by the community here. Thank you also to the Sagan National Colloquium for pulling together scholars and students and concerned citizens to think about questions of waste and all of their associated issues. Specifically, thanks to Jim Peoples and to Nick Crane and to John Krieger for causing that to come about. I'm the first speaker in the series. In 2 weeks, you will hear from Max Liberon. I will ask you to tell all your friends and family about Max. She's one of, I think, the most important scholars of waste issues working today, and she will knock your socks off. So if I can just give a plug for the next in the series. Tonight I'm going to attempt to do three things simultaneously, and you can tell me how well this works. As Jim mentioned, I have been affiliated with the Department of Sanitation for many years, and I would love nothing better than to give you the people and the places and the technologies and the histories and the infrastructures and the conundra and the adventures and the camaraderie, the richness of the field. But of course, I can't do that here and now. So I'm going to give you a sort of a slide presentation collage. In fact, I'll just get that rolling. This is going to just cycle, and it's photographs from various aspects of all of those variables that I just mentioned. So this is a visual introduction to histories, people, places, systems. There are many more details in the book, and when considering what to bring to you tonight, I thought of talking about the book, but you can read the book. I want to try something new this evening. So the three parts are the slideshow, which is just going to run, and if I talk so long that it gets to the end, it'll just start over. The second is I'm going to talk with you right now. I'm going to walk through some ideas about how waste can be understood inside the anthropological arguments about gift exchange. We've been, as anthropologists, playing with ideas and problems and possibilities of what it means to give and to receive a gift. So I'm gonna walk through some of those theories, I hope in an accessible and entertaining way, and then talk about where garbage fits within that framework. And then finally, I'm going to give you a puzzle. And my request is that when I get to the puzzle and I introduce you to the puzzle, the evening will then transform into a conversation where perhaps you can help me think through the puzzle. And I won't give away just yet what that is. But so let me start with the idea of garbage and gift exchange. And I'm going to read some and talk some. So if I start reading, don't despair. I will not be only reading the presentation tonight, but some of it I will. As a category of material culture, trash betrays the difficulty of assigning permanence to objects that we wish to imbue with meaning and identity across time. The persistence of trash or waste as a daily creation and as a permanent collection in monumental landfills around the world represents inadvertent durability and accidental innovations against loss. Landfills are not merely repositories of dead stuff, but are also passive forms of competitive exchange that may be understood as inverted potlatch. Those of you not familiar with potlatch within anthropology, don't worry, I'm going to talk us through that a little bit. So gift giving as a problem inside social science theory was addressed early on by the French sociologist Marcel Mauss, who said that gift-giving establishes ties of reciprocity and solidarity and superiority. So he was one of the early forays into kind of thinking through what is it? What does it mean to give gifts? Gift-giving is something that happens in every culture, as far as we know, across time. So when we find universals, and there aren't all that many, we really chew on them. Maurice Godelier came into the conversation many years later, and he said that gift-giving, yes, is about reciprocity and solidarity and superiority. It's also always a gesture of either generosity or violence. So hold that thought. More recently, Annette Weiner, an anthropologist at NYU and my former boss, she stepped into conversations, theoretical musings about gift exchange, and she said, yeah, everything that's been said, that rings true. It's reciprocity, it's generosity, it can be a form of violence, and I'll address that in a minute. But she had an additional variable that she felt was essential. She argues that it also, in some contexts, reinforces the giver's lineage, family status, history, and that it authenticates the past and ensures the future of the giver. So that's a little puzzling at first glance. In the Trobriand Islands, where she did her fieldwork, if a man gives a gift to his son, after the man dies, the gift is returned to his sisters because they claim it as part of their descent group. This is a matrilineal culture, so descent is figured through the maternal line. More contemporary way to understand this. If you were asked what objects in your own life are most precious to you, probably it's not going to be the 60-inch screen, flat screen TV, or even the new fancy car. It will probably be, and this is according to studies done by various people in various moments, it's things like the photo album that goes back four generations, or the cooking pots that your great-grandmother brought here when she immigrated and that you now have, or the family piano, or particular forms of music. In other words, markers of your own lineage that look backwards in time and that as you carry them forward, carry you forward in time. So Annette Wiener had a name for this kind of gift. She called it inalienable, and I mostly always mangle the word when I say it, so forgive me when I mangle it in a minute. But so an inalienable gift is such because it's exclusive. It has its exclusive and cumulative identity with a particular series of owners through time. Its history is authenticated by fictive or true genealogies, origin myths, sacred ancestors, gods. They are transcendent treasures to be guarded against all the exigencies that might force their loss. So she called this mechanism of gift giving, where the lineage and history and the heritage of ownership through time adheres to the object. She called this keeping while giving. And by that she means that I may give to, let's say, my son, the grandfather clock that my father gave to me, that his father gave to him, that his, there's a date in there somewhere from 1757. I don't know if it's a real date. Dad thinks it is. Maybe someone else wrote that after the fact. But when I give this to my son, he can now trace it back through all those generations as being our family clock that has far more meaning than if I went to a flea market and bought a grandfather clock and handed it to him. There's history and meaning and time and continuity attached to that clock by my family. So keeping while giving establishes ties through gift exchange that transcend temporal limitations. They guard against change and time and decay. And if you think about human existence, there's very little that we have in the world that transcends any of our individuality in a way that actually does stand against time, the great corrosive force that will, well, now I'm going to get real bleak sounding, and I don't mean to do that, but time is pretty potent. I'll just leave it at that, as you know. All right, so let's pause on classical anthropological gift exchange theories. I'm not going to talk about garbage. Let me just very briefly remind you, most talked about reciprocity, Godelier talked about generosity or violence, and Annette Wiener talked about permanence, forms of permanence established through gift giving. Hover that, as one of my favorite professors used to say, just hover that a minute. So let's consider garbage. Italo Calvino posits that when we throw out the trash, what's left behind defines who we are. So every day or whenever it is that we let go of our discards, that's a way of making clear to ourselves and to our world, here's what I am. Here, what's left, what remains, it is me. That is me. Mary Douglas, classically an anthropologist of, she's one of the great grandparents of the discipline, in her very famous book, Purity and Danger, talks about how pollution can become a form of taboo and thus a threat to moral order, but also sort of the order of the universe. It's a very potent, it is such a dangerous threat that people who break taboos against pollution have to go through rituals to cleanse themselves, to be reintegrated into the community so that it can actually cause someone to be cast out of the community in a way that is, it's as if they're no longer alive. So that adheres to, is part of our understandings of garbage. And then Frederick Jameson mentioned that the current moment is marked in part by our fragmented and schizophrenic decentering and dispersion, by which he means ways in which we are no longer linked, connected, bound to each other. And if you consider garbage as a symptom of that contemporary moment of our the disillusion of our ties to each other, I think you can make the argument that garbage as a category of material culture inverts the gift exchange theories of earlier social science. Here's how. So it's always reciprocal, as most said, and creating garbage is reciprocal, except that it's reciprocal with myself. I throw out the Kleenex after I've used it, and thus I have cleansed myself and given myself a clearer definition of myself, as Italo Calvino would argue. There's a generosity to it in that if I kept everything that we are deeply trained to let go of, to discard, I am soon going to be qualified as a hoarder. I'm going to have people offering me various forms of mental health assistance. I will be endangering my own physical health. In other words, if we didn't let go of our stuff when it's time for us to throw it away, we would be harming ourselves. So in that sense, discarding is a form of generosity. I know it sounds a little cracked, but bear with me. But it is, of course, also a violence. So in Nick Crane's class today, we were talking about ways in which violence of displacement happens, even if you clean up a polluted area, a brownfield, that material goes somewhere else. So wherever garbage lands, in English, I talk about this a lot because I love this so much. In English, the English language, our phrasing is to throw the trash away, wherever that may be, the fantasy. The away is always, of course, very firmly grounded in someone's space, life, community. So that's the violence of garbage. So we're still hitting these points of exchange theory, but sort of the dark version of that. And then when Weiner talks about permanence, gift-giving as an inalienable measure, what is more permanent than our waste? What is a more enduring marker of human existence on this planet than the debris that we have left behind? Going back to ancient times as the guts of archaeological analysis all over the world. And now, as we enter what many are calling the Anthropocene, we've even come to create, by default, not by intention, a new geological formation called plastiglomerate, which is where plastic melds with mineral. And the supposition is that in centuries from now, when geologists define the measure of this era, it is the layer of plastiglomerates that they will read in the geological record to mark the Anthropocene. So that's the setup of exchange theory, classically kind of constructed, and then garbage as the sinister inversion, if you will. So let's put those things somewhere. And I'm going to do two more parallels here. Potlatch was an extravagant ceremony that was part of the culture of Northwest Coast peoples in North America and a few others. There are arguments that it was also found among Trobriganders and some other people in the Pacific Islands. But it's a ceremonial way of establishing superiority and dominance, and basically it's a contest that you win by giving away as much stuff as you can and by destroying blankets and these big copper ingots and pots and pans. The material variables changed with colonial imposition, but the acts themselves were to Western eyes, to colonial eyes, missionaries and bureaucrats, they were these devastating travesties where peoples, the indigenous peoples would come together and basically have a huge party and just destroy vast quantities of material, which seemed to many missionaries and other colonial powers as an example of an illogic that must be inherent to native thinking and that is justification for further imposition of colonial power, because if this is how the indigenous people are going to act, well, we really need to come in here and bring some logic to the situation because it's out of control. Franz Boas, the anthropologist, pointed out that potlatch is a form of record keeping because the only way to know how to counter the group that did potlatch last time and won is to keep a very careful account of what was given, what was destroyed, and you then host the next one, but you do better. You give more and you destroy more. So it's a one-upsmanship. And it even ties in with John Locke, who argued that land that is not worked to a productive goal is wasteful, wasted, and to see potlatch was proof that indigenous peoples were inherently wasteful, right? These are the arguments from back in the day. So let's look at landfills. Let's look at what I call the monumental landfills of the 20th and 21st centuries. The example I know best is Freshkills. In fact, there have been some pictures of it in the slides. If potlatch is extravagant, landfills are extravagant. Landfills are mind-blowingly extravagant collections of wasted stuff, spent things, dead objects. It's property that's given in the sense that it's given into the void of the away. And it is, as potlatch is a meticulous record keeping, so are landfills. Bill Rathje, an archaeologist classically trained at Harvard who ended up working out of Arizona and Stanford, spent his career demonstrating how, no matter how fine your memory, if someone gives you a survey asking about your household habits and what you have bought and what you have discarded and what is your lifestyle, and you answer as honestly as possible, your trash will tell a more truthful, more accurate, more detailed story, always. So landfills are records of ourselves as a people and a place and time, wherever those landfills are, that it's going to be hard to argue with them when the archaeologists of the future begin to dig them up. Potlatch reflects the social order and forms of control. Landfills reflect social order and forms of control. Who gets to choose where a landfill goes? Whose voice is not heard when that siting choice is made and concerns about the effect on a local community or the local environment are ignored? Whose power directs the first truck to dump the first load? And who never has a say? Those are profoundly straightforward issues of social control and power, and they play out all over the country in ways, again, going back to Nick's class from today, in ways that play out, that are still devastating to communities. Often communities, lower income communities or communities of color, not always, but that there's a pattern in that direction. If missionaries understood that potlatch did not contribute to productive activity or the conservation of life, neither does a landfill. So I think I like to look at a landfill like Freshkills and see it as New York City's, well, let me back up. Freshkills landfill was New York City's landfill. Robert Moses, the urban planner and dictator, sort of New York for many decades, he opened it in 1948, and he promised. I have the New York Times stories and the many other sources. He promised it would be open for 3 years only. He wanted to fill in a marsh to establish a footing for a bridge to help link his network of highways. And so 1951 comes and goes, and so it's going to be open a little bit longer, and then 1958, and then 1990, and then they're thinking about when to close it, and someone comes up with the idea of making it into a ski resort because the hills are now very steep in a part of the world that is otherwise very flat. A ski resort on a landfill would be fine, except that decomposing organic material emits heat, so it wouldn't be the most efficient way to have, you'd have interesting challenges having a ski resort on a landfill. Short version of the long story, Freshkills closed in 2001, not 1951. New York City today imagines itself to be a glittering global capital, and I think in many ways it is. It wouldn't exist if it didn't have a place for its discards to go, if New Yorkers had to live with their cast-offs in their own streets and homes and alleys and parks. it's hard to imagine what it would be, but it'd be nothing like what it is today. So in a very real sense, Freshkills allowed New York City to become what it is. And in that way, I see it not just as a sort of an inverted potlatch, but also as a museum of us across 50 some odd years, uncatalogued and unvisited. It's highly visible, but you can't see it. You can see the hills, but you can't see what makes those hills. So there are beautiful contradictions inherent in Freshkills particularly, but really all of the monumental landfills of North America and elsewhere. Any landfill built before the near the end of the 20th century, one of the big, big landfills, the material, especially at the bottom layers, does not decompose because the weight is such that the little microbial stuff that gets in there to help the decomposition happen, it's mummified, essentially. There's nothing happening in there. Rathje, the archaeologist, used that to great effect when he took core samples from landfills all over the country and then showed what he pulled up. You can read the newspapers from the 1950s. He had hot dogs that looked like you could throw them on the grill that were buried. The way you date landfill core samples is from newspapers because municipal recycling of paper is a relatively recent innovation. So older layers, that's how you figure out what year it was. So that puts together exchange theory, garbage as the inversion of it, and then linking potlatch and landfills as counter expressions of each other. I will add the illogic of waste that colonial powers assumed of potlatch practices. Imagine the anthropologists from Mars coming here and looking at our waste practices. Obviously, these natives, we cannot be trusted to organize our lives on our own because this practice is illogical and extravagant. So they'll probably have to take over. If we just turn the perspective a little bit, it becomes, I think the puzzle of our waste practices becomes very evident, and I don't have answers for them. But that's a good segue into the puzzle that I want your help solving. Did this stop at this slide? Oh, man. Well, that's Freshkills. I'll run through just a few of these. There are people on that barge. You can't quite see them, I don't think. These are just pictures from the field or from back in the day. This is a new garage that won all kinds of positive attention from the New York Times recently. It looks a little boxy here, but it's actually built to LEED Gold standards, and all the internal water is reused for the green roof, and it has these fins that pivot according to the time of day and the temperature as a climate control. It's a remarkable structure. So I'm going to move to the puzzle, which requires me to shut this down a little bit before I had wanted to, but I can let it roll during the Q&A as well. Bear with me while I pull up the next piece. Okay, the Molina collection. So here's the puzzle. Nelson Molina was a New York City sanitation worker for 34 years. He was born and raised in East Harlem. He worked out of the garage that is the East Harlem Garage. From a very young age, as one of the oldest of six children without a lot of money, he would go out a couple of weeks before Christmas and find toys that he had been thrown out as families are getting ready to bring in new gifts for children. And he would bring them home and fix them, and those would be the gifts for his siblings. This habit of what he calls picking carried forward. And as a sanitation worker out of this particular garage, across almost all of his 34 years, he brought into the garage treasures that he found in the trash. So what you're seeing here is his collection of objects that he has pulled out of the garbage. That's the only provenance, if this were a museum conversation, provenance of anything in this garage. He now has, it's a space, probably it's bigger than this because the building is so old that it's no longer strong enough to hold trucks on the second floor where they used to park. So his collection started as a very modest assortment of small objects, matchbox cars and baseballs and perfume bottles, in the locker room. But as the space expanded that was available to him, the collection expanded, and it now fills a kind of a football field where everything you see, all the pictures on the wall, everything, he found in the trash. One of my students did a 20-minute documentary about him, followed him on the route, and then talked with him in detail about this it's assemblage. Nelson, I feel, is not a hoarder for a few reasons. There is a deep literature, as some of you probably know, on hoarding and hoarders, and the difference between hoarding and collecting is a thin line, and there's debate about where to draw that line. But Nelson has not taken home this material. He has not stashed it in his bedroom and made his home unlivable and caused himself harm because he's now no longer able to get from the kitchen to the bathroom, which are conditions that really serious hoarders can sometimes create for themselves. This is all still in the garage, and it's extremely carefully and beautifully curated. They're not randomly placed. They are put together with a sensibility that is unique to Nelson. People often, other sanitation workers, bring objects to him as contributions to his collection. He may take them, he may not. They have to pass muster with him. He's a little hard-pressed to define exactly what qualifies, but he knows it when he sees it. Nelson retired this past, about 10 months ago. So the Department of Sanitation looked at this. There are tens of thousands of objects in this collection. And they said, well, it was thrown out once, we're going to throw it out again, because what are we going to do with this? And then calmer heads prevailed, and they said, well, okay, we're going to put it on eBay. So, thankfully, calmer heads prevailed. We now have until October of this year to figure out what to do with this. There is the beginnings of a museum of sanitation in the works, and it makes sense that this would be a part of the museum of sanitation, but this does not reflect the stories and infrastructure and people and the guts of the work like some of those images did until I got stuck on that one. And like what the stories that I tell in my book, they're not reflected here. This is a separate thing, but it's a connected thing. So one puzzle that I invite you to brainstorm with me is, what might we do with it? Here are the constraints. It takes up a lot of space. We're in Manhattan. Space is very expensive. That's constraint one. Constraint two, should we keep it together? This was my class last night. A group of students were working with Nelson to come to know the collection better. But so do we keep it linked, or do we are united, or do we give parcels of it to different places and maybe there's a rotating show? So that's an ongoing, not conundrum, it's a project that we're working on. But here's the big puzzle that I mentioned at the beginning. If garbage is something that we cast off and is gone, but you get a sense from these photographs, there's some genuine treasures in here, almost by any measure. There's some real treasures, and there's a whole lot of things in here that I see and love and someone else is unmoved by, but then they see things like the superhero doll collection or the Furbies or the roller skates or the 8-track tapes or the baseball cards or and they go nuts for that particular variable. So what is it? What are these objects if they have come into someone's life and then been cast out of that life for whatever reason, by whatever means? They're now on the curb and their fate is supposed to be the back of a collection truck, and then depending on where in the infrastructure they are, it's going to be a landfill or a waste to energy facility, meaning an incinerator. But no, that's the old ramp where the trucks used to come up. These objects have all been pulled out of that waste stream, and now they are part of this curatorial extravagance in a positive sense. Working with Nelson has taught me that just as art can be made by people who are deeply trained and who belong to a class of the creative class, understood to be making creative expressions that we then put into high-end museums, and that there is also art that people simply make, not trained, but as a heartfelt expression of whatever they're expressing in a, sometimes it's called outsider art or primitive art, but it has a great emotional, can have a great emotional impact. Curating also is a professional skill. And there is now also, this is was one of my lessons, folk curation. Nelson is not a trained curator, but his sensibilities of what goes together, when you walk the collection, that's the downstairs, that's the some of the snow equipment. When you walk his collection, the assemblages make sense. Sometimes, and other times you have to say, "What? Explain this table to me." So what does that mean? What meaning adheres to these objects? Their route is completely unexpected and unlikely, and it doesn't follow the path it's supposed to. Are these pollution? If I'm playing with these Furbies that have been in the garbage, am I now contaged or tainted because they have been given the status of a cast-off? And cast-off sounds sort of neat. Garbage sounds messy. These were in the garbage. Some of them were messy. He cleans them. When need be, he repairs them. He invests himself in them. So the puzzle of the evening that I invite you to explore with me is, how do we understand these objects through this very unlikely path of coming back into, sort of back into life, but now they have a very different life? And how do we, what is their magic? I can't convey it to you quite through the pictures, but when you walk it, I've seen people come through this collection in tears. I've seen people get angry at the possibility that this collection will be broken apart in some way, because they say this is the history of New York City in the last century is on these tables and hung on these walls and found in this garage. So it has a weight, it has a meaning, but it's not like if you just went out and someone gave you all this stuff, or if this were a flea market and you're walking through a flea market, it wouldn't have the same resonance. There's something redemptive about this. There's something about rescuing these objects. There's a, to use a jargony word, but I like it, it's salvific. There's something about salvation that these treasures have not been doomed to the infinite darkness of the landfill. And the public is beginning to show tremendous interest in this. We're offering tours. One of the pictures with a big group was from last October, where we ran two tours of 25 people each, and Nelson is always on hand and he answers all the questions, and he's a very down-to-earth guy who tells great stories about the objects. I will conclude this part of my talking at you with this story from him. Many people ask him, what's the most important object here for you? And he goes to a Star of David that was cut from an I-beam from the September 11th wreckage, and that was inscribed as coming from that source. Many of the workers at Freshkills, where the September 11th material was taken, made sure to pull some of the I-beam metal, and they made Stars of David and crosses and a few other objects that were sort of symbolically significant. But Nelson found the Star of David that he points to in the trash. And for him, it's many people get very upset if they see an American flag in the trash. And Nelson does, he will pull, even if he weren't a picker, he would pull flags from the trash if he found them there. But the Star of David cut from the metal, from an I-beam, from the trade towers, destroyed on September 11th. He can't get his head around the fact that somebody threw that out. So that to him is, that's what he shows people. It's small. It's about yay big. So I know what that object means to him, but I don't know how to understand this beautiful, unlikely, crazy, overwhelming, emotionally moving, logistically challenging assortment. So what do you think? I throw the question to you and invite your reflections and comments. I never did it this way before, folks, so let's see if this I know a few names I can call on a couple of people. Jason. You got to talk real loud. Oh, you got to talk into the mic.
Cool. I assume just the cost of entering the museum is not enough to sustain paying for the space?
Well, actually, thank you for that. It's not a museum at all. He calls it that, but it's a sanitation garage. And as someone just in the public, you can't just walk in. It's on the second floor. The stairs are very steep and uneven. You have to have permission, and you have to have to walk that collection. The way we're doing it now, I will accompany you. This is on me, actually. I'm the calmer head that said to sanitation, please don't throw it out or sell it on eBay. Let's figure out what to do next. So, and even if it were publicly accessible, it's a municipal facility. They can't charge anything. We've already paid for it through taxes, right? So that's not an option yet. But I hadn't thought at all about the role of admission in fundraising for figuring out its next steps. So I will put that in the book as something to think about down the line.
There's also like Kickstarter and
yes.
stuff like that. I don't. Yeah.
Yeah. No, we're gonna walk that forward as soon as I have permission. This is another element that's fascinating. If I say to you the anthropology of bureaucracy is really, really interesting, I am sure that most of you don't believe me because that sounds like what you dip into when you have insomnia and you really want to go to sleep. I will tell you that there's some very good anthropology, social science. Considerations of bureaucracy, but if you want to look at culturally complex, almost randomly built, and as we all know, sometimes very frustrating constructions, bureaucracy is it, man. And each has its own flavor. It has taken me many years to learn the bureaucracy of sanitation enough not to keep offending people or getting myself locked out of conversations because I said the wrong thing to the wrong one, or I wrote an email and I put the recipients' names in the wrong order. So there's a power underneath the structure of any bureaucracy. And the more you pay attention to that, first of all, the more successful you'll navigate it. So next time you're at the DMV, think about that. But it also, in terms of how to walk this forward, my next step is to sit down with officials in sanitation with a plan, and I have some things in place. We have a list of every cultural and political kind of advocacy organization in the neighborhood of East Harlem, which is culturally its own fascinating corner of the city. But his collection also speaks for more than just that neighborhood, and it also speaks for sanitation citywide, and it also speaks for us as a people. So, yes, Kickstarter. If they give me the green light. What else you got? These are good ideas.
What is keeping this place going costing the sanitation department now that it wasn't before?
The garage operations. Did everyone hear the question? What's keeping it going, but like paying for the cost of it? Think of a two-story building, and on outside are collection trucks, and this kind of thing. And then inside are the FELs, the front end loaders, and the salt spreaders, and some of the officers' cars. And then upstairs is Nelson's collection. The building is going to be there no matter what. They have to pay the electricity. They have to, because the locker rooms for the workers are there, the offices for, this is the district that is responsible for cleaning East Harlem. So you have a superintendent who's there every day and another one who's there every night. You have supervisors, you have sanitation workers. So there's a whole world that operates out of that building, whether or not this collection exists. Because the space now is mostly, the space he has filled is the space that the trucks used to occupy. It would otherwise be empty. What does not happen, because they're scheduled to move out of this space sometime in the next few years to a new garage, when the roof leaks, or the bulb blows out, the investment in repairs is enough to prevent harm, but not enough to actually solve the problem in a longer term way. So once they move out of that building, it's already been, it already technically belongs to the hospital across the street. They're going to tear it down and build a new hospital facility. So part of the charm of it is walking through the, like, the uneven floor and the gritty walls and the fluorescent lighting, and we can't keep it. That's just off the table. But the cost, there is no cost. The garage is going to run whether this collection is in it or not. I realize I've made a bit of a gap between all of the gift theory stuff and the Nelson Molina collection stuff. And you walk. I mean, I ask about the puzzle of Nelson's collection. Feel free to ask me or challenge me about anything at all. Yes, sir, in the back.
So just to recap, what's the relationship between gift giving and garbage?
So in its shortest iteration, it's the opposite. It's the inversion. It fulfills the same mechanisms, but it's like the Darth Vader version instead of the Luke Skywalker version, and that's not quite right either, because I don't mean to cast garbage as evil, but it has reciprocity, but not of me to you, of me to myself. It has generosity because it opens up space, just as a gift is a generous gesture. It has violence because when I open up space with the garbage, I impose that on someone else. And gift giving as a form of asserting power and control can be a violent, there can be a violent undertone to that. It can establish, if we take it to the potlatch landfill comparison, extravagant quantities of it demonstrate power and who controls what forms of social determination about geography, where things are turned into landfills or not, whose voices are heard and whose are ignored, according to what measure. With potlatch, it wasn't so much whose voices are heard and whose are ignored as an extravagant display of power by, I can afford to get rid of, to obliterate more stuff than you can, so I win. In a sense, Freshkills was once the largest landfill in the world. It's not anymore, and I'm a little sad about that. How absurd to be sad that now the landfill outside of California is actually bigger by square mileage. Freshkills still is the biggest in terms of, in North America, in terms of volume. I believe the one outside Rio called Jajingramashu is bigger by volume in terms of the world comparisons. So I could go on, but does that answer your question?
So this place sort of makes the job of an archaeologist easier. Have people gone in and actually studied these objects?
The picture of the four women with Nelson, that's an embryonic start to exactly that. Our intention is not to catalog every object, because it would take four people the rest of their lives, I think, if that were the team. But to begin to catalog in bigger clumps, like by table, perhaps. So you have tables of toys that are wooden and cloth, and you have tables of old dead cell phone and pager technology, and the typewriter table, which is my favorite, and the Furby wall, of course. People love the Furby wall. There is a counterpart to this that I didn't bring up in these slides, but that is a place in Brooklyn called Dead Horse Bay, which was landfilled across several different decades for several different reasons. The last layer was dumped there between early February and mid-March of 1953, and then the shallowest of layers was put over it, and then city officials drove away. That collection of stuff, which came from homes destroyed to make room for highways, so not household garbage, but households, that is reasserting itself into the world as the edge of the beach erodes with tides and wind, and the objects that then pop out of the what I call the active bank, which is a landfill term, but now it's the opposite, are, imagine, the way I describe this to students is to think about if you were the props master for a film about 1953 working class Brooklyn, and your job was to populate the apartment of this family with every object that would have been a routine part of their lives. Now put that all in this very shallow landfill and let it regurgitate itself back into the world. And when, I'll show you pictures of that. It was in the other slideshow. I'll pull those up. But Nelson's collection is the, it's the opposite of that, in that everything is saved from that fate, but it's often the exact same inventory. So Danvers Bay is haunting. So is Nelson's collection, but in a happy kind of way, sort of, or at least a less less haunting kind of way than, or less dark haunting kind of way than Dead Horse Bay. Yeah, that's going to be a little bit hard to find all those. Let me do this a different way. So yeah, archaeologists of the future have their work already done for them, which is great, but I'm not sure that matters now in terms of what the collection is going to become. So Nick, can I let you do the mic, and I'm just going to dig up these Dead Horse Bay pictures, which I don't remember.
Have you spoken with the people who worked with Nelson over this time and how he was just allowed to start putting things and how their, I guess, their point of view of him putting stuff there over time? And if their perspective of maybe originally him collecting garbage turned into something that they all enjoyed or don't enjoy as well?
One of the reasons that Nelson was allowed to build this collection was because he is a profoundly well-loved fellow. He's the kind of person who, whatever assignment you give him, even if it's something unjust or not technically part of his job, he'll do it, and he'll do it well. And when he's doing the part of his job that is what he's supposed to be doing, he does it extremely well. He's also generous to a fault, and if he's on your side, you have a profoundly loyal ally. And anyone who's worked with him long enough to become friends with him not only recognizes that, but relishes that. Keeping stuff you find in the trash is technically illegal in New York City and against the policy of the Department of Sanitation. So here's Nelson with this huge, with what you see. And when he first started getting media attention, one of the questions was, wait, I thought this was illegal. And the department, my image of them is they kind of went, hold on a second. He didn't take it home, so it's okay. But in fact, I think that's right. This is not for his own enjoyment or his personal benefit. He's making no money off of this. He doesn't sell these things to, like, Antiques Roadshow and experts like that. That's another thing I'd like to pull in to, like, that's, I don't even know what it's worth, right? This collection. They mostly love it in no way interferes with the operation of the garage. If it ever had, it would have been dismantled. That absolutely can't happen. But there's a lot of affection for it. His godson works there, so does one of his sons, but his godson works there as a sanitation worker, and he said to his godson, okay, I'm retiring, you take it over. And his godson's like, no. Nelson's still there several days a week. He's still repairing things, he's still rearranging tables. He had some things in storage that now he's put out. There's a whole table of photographs that I didn't show you that go back to, I think the oldest one is 1907. There are diplomas. There are baptismal certificates. There are things that I used to assume don't become trash. But what I've learned working in trash is that everything becomes trash eventually. Don't mean to have that be a downer. It's just, I mean, look at 3,000 years ago. Did they think that the column that was going to be a ruin? Of course not. Yeah, well. So this is a little bit of Dead Horse Bay. It's not really giving you the... Oh, it's called Dead Horse Bay because in 1859 until the 1930s, it became the world's largest concentration of rendering facilities. That's a place where if you have a dead animal, like a horse that dropped dead in the streets of the city, you take the body there to be cut up and turned into saleable commodities like fertilizer and boot black, and from the mane, the oil underneath the mane of a horse, they would take the oil and sell it as a way, if you were bald and you wanted your hair to come back, they would sell you the, yeah, all kind, yeah, very, they used to say of horses, I mean of pigs, that they reused everything except the squeal. You could say of the horse, they reused everything except the neigh? Whinny, thank you. Yeah, these are all from Dead Horse Bay. And I take students there too, and I'll be taking this class there in the spring. I can send you a website. This might be better. No, this is not going to work. I can send you a website that is a little bit more detailed. A couple of radio pieces. So this is where the piers were, where the barges came in with the dead animals. And that's a cast iron frying pan. Any of you who cook with cast iron know that I could have taken that home, and with a lot of elbow grease, I could be using that now. That we had a very strong ethic of not taking from the beach because, first of all, it's National Park Service land. So it's as if you go to Yosemite and start taking things home from Yosemite. And secondly, these are future artifacts for future students, archaeologists, historians. But the counter to that is the wind and the sea takes them away anyway. So if I take them away and use them in a class, isn't that better than letting the sea take them? But then what about artists and scavengers who take this stuff and sell it? Is that wrong? Is that proper? Should it be allowed? That's a debate, and it's a heated one. People have strong feelings on both sides of that. Anyone know what this is? And those of you who are my age, you probably recognize this, so don't answer. Students in the room, do you know what this is? I think it was a model for R2-D2. But so you see the handle on the far side? You raise that, you put the half citrus, and then you pull it down and it squeezes into the glass for juice underneath, right? Nylons. Who knew that the early version of nylons was going to last many, many, many lifetimes? And they form these, I find them rather creepy, entanglements around tree roots and other debris all over Dead Horse Bay. That's a little bit of Dead Horse Bay. It's like the anti-Nelson. This is a boat that I think you can't see it anymore because it's buried. But this is, that was not part of the land, of when it was a landfill. That was just somebody beached their boat. And then they probably reported it stolen and insurance paid. I don't know. Maybe not. This is low tide. This is typical in many of... So this is like Nelson's collection, except that it's been... It wasn't redeemed. It wasn't rescued in any way. Oh, this... And so Floyd Bennett Field was the first municipal airport in New York City. This is one of the old original hangars. That one you saw. Yeah. Very common to find nail polish. This one has a broken cap, but many other examples of nail polish with the cap intact, and you can actually unscrew it and the nail polish is still like it's been there for decades and it's still as if you could just use it. So that's that for Dead Horse Bay. I have a lot more if you want to see them. But
Robin, I'm going to put Nick on here.
Good.
So thank you for giving us so much to think about. But it seemed like, you know, as I was kind of mulling over your question and the puzzle, that Nelson's collection or museum kind of seems to boil down to a museum of human care and the fact that, you know, garbage is usually the product of carelessness or objects that we discard because we've lost effective attachments to them, things that we no longer see a use for. And to find a collection of ones that were kind of salvaged from that and brought back to life and also put on display, that sort of sense of human care, I think has a kind of interesting kind of moral dimension to it that seems that probably people resonate with. And your description of him also seems to align with that. So that was one of the things that was going through my mind. But also, you know, garbage seems to be this undifferentiated mass of objects, and by individually selecting objects out of that mass and recognizing their singularity seems to be something that's really kind of significant about that project.
And it reminded me a little bit, I was reading Ta-Nehisi Coates' book, Between the World and Me, which probably a lot of people here have also been impacted by. And there's a really special passage of that book when he talks to his son about how slavery is oftentimes described as this indistinguishable mass of humanity. But he says that, you know, we need to think about the individual woman who appreciated the way that light struck in an opening in the forest, or, you know, the complicated way in which she loved her mother, or the way that her sister talked too much. And so I think he does this amazing job of kind of pulling this person out of this undistinguishable mass of humanity and sort of highlighting that individual. And that's what it seems like, you know, is happening, you know, in that collection, that he's really kind of bringing out that beauty of those individual objects. So I don't know if, you know, if you want to comment on that. Those, these are things that are kind of going through my mind.
Well, the comment I would make is thank you. I just took notes. That's beautiful. And Museum of Human Care. Perhaps it's, well, I'd love to keep talking. I can imagine the Museum of Human Care as what this could evolve into, and also the title of one of the all-time best poems ever that you must write.
I wrote down one thing while I was listening here. Oh, lots of things, but the idea of like para garbage.
Say again. The
para garbage. P-A-R-A, sort of things that are garbage, but then not, which a lot of these things were, all these things were pulled out of garbage. I think about recyclables that you separate out. So it's not like stuff that you would buy or own or cherish, but it's sort of not just waste that you would dump. So it's in that in-between, caught in that in-between space. So I don't know, I was trying to think about how things like recyclables, how this collection sort of, there's that space in between waste and not waste where this is sitting. But it also made me kind of sad, even though that collection looks a lot like my office, the vision I had for it was actually, I mean, it's almost romanticizing these things. It felt like you have to make a statement with that, those materials. And I mean, one statement would be to just throw them in a landfill and bury them, but then it would be out of sight, out of mind. So I had this vision of taking that whole room of material and compacting it together into a solid block. And it would take up a lot less room, but it would still have the effect of being able to look and see all the intricacies of all the things in there. But it would give you that sense, so you can interact with it, but that give you that sense of loss and throw away without sort of being this romantic collection of things that were saved from the landfill.
So, John, I invite you to New York to walk the collection and then tell me the same thing. Because Yeah, but you wouldn't feel it. You wouldn't feel it. You wouldn't recognize the Cat Care book from 1930 and the silent films from the silent film era and the reel-to-reel projector and the, I mean, the crystal. There's a whole table just of crystal. I have friends who love crystal, and when they get a gift of crystal, they put it in the shelf that holds the crystal, and there it is. The other thing about the collection, which is a little bit like collecting Mongo anyway, and I neglected to mention Mongo. Mongo is the, if you are walking anywhere or if you are out in the world and you encounter something that was discarded and you think, well, that's pretty nice. I'm going to keep that. You have just Mongoed. It's a verb. And the thing itself is Mongo. So no one knows the root of the word. I actually had... at the time, she was the editor of the American Slang Dictionary, and she put her sleuths on it. They couldn't find its origin. But it's used in New York and in Boston to indicate treasures that you find. So Mongo, one of the things that's thick about this collection is not just the quantity and variety, but the way in which each individual has a... There's a different element that jumps out and grabs them. So the table full of the cooking utensils that the oldest, the newest one is from 1940. I appreciate those as design objects, but to see someone whose great-grandmother taught her to cook using those same kinds of tools, suddenly there's a whole other thing going on for her at that table, right? So to crush it into, I'd lose that particularity. And let me also just briefly tell you a parallel. In the September 11th Memorial Museum is a, it's in its own special case. It's very big, and it's a piece of the material from the wreckage that through heat was seared into one mass. You can't see what was in there. And in fact, some of the families are upset that it's part of the display at all, because who knows who might be inside, right? So I appreciate the efficiency of the idea. I think we would lose something if we boxed it all up like that. Sanitation would like the idea though a lot, because then the problem would be solved. But I do invite you to all of you, let me know. I do the tours. We'll walk through the Molina collection, and Nelson will be there, but you in particular.
So I was thinking about the idea of the Museum of Care, and how we were talking about how garbage is almost reverse gift giving, that it's defining oneself not by what one has, but by what one has thrown away. And the museum is sort of a reclamation of that those they've been saved from that. And then I was also thinking about how we talked about when gifts are given through like generation to generation, that it there's a history behind it. And I don't know what the relation with the sanitation garage to the hospital is, but if certain things strike people when they walk through that place, if you were to open it up for hospital patients to perhaps take what strikes them and perhaps recycle it so that it again becomes something that is meaningful and passed down, that, hey, I was sick, I got this at the Museum of Reclaimed Garbage, and I passed it on to you, and maybe 200 years from now, that'll still be in somebody's house, or it might be in the garbage, but at least symbolically, it seems to sort of turn the backwards gift-giving back to gift-giving again.
Another beautiful idea. Thank you. I like that a lot.
A bit different, but I remember hearing of this artist in China who walked through Beijing with a vacuum cleaner and took the smog and turned that smog into a brick of Beijing's pollution. And in turn, he used that brick, gave it to a construction company that put it into a new, like, apartment building, right? So, actually, I think there's a lot of parallels to what Dana's talking about, where, you know, you sort of reuse these objects. You put them back into the cycle of humanity, basically. Yeah.
I hadn't thought of any of that at all. That would restore the flow. Something that, if you study ways to quickly learn, it's about flow. It can't stop. Once it stops, it's either then that's where the hazard becomes truly dangerous, or that's where you've imposed it on a distant other, like it's now incinerator ash that goes to a landfill, or it's a landfill, or it's litter, or it's... But to take the collection, the Molina collection, and put it back into the flow of gift giving and of a future life that is not on a shelf but is circulating again, there's a harmony, like a poetic kind of balance in that. I think you guys are really good. I have to say, you guys are really good. Anybody else? I'm looking for the best Dead Horse Bay pictures, and this is not
One, I had a somewhat similar thought. I mean, you could, there are artists who go through the garbage and make rather impressive pieces of sculpture, but I don't know if I really like that idea. There's something kind of forced about that. I think an idea that seems a little bit more attractive as a New Yorker is I think that there are probably a lot of New Yorkers who have small objects that they've accumulated that you could kind of turn into sort of a larger project about remembering through small things in New York City. And I think to me that seems like the charm and the magic of the space is I think we're kind of at a point in time where people are really invested in remembering and have a lot of investment in nostalgia. So I think that kind of turning it into a larger project of memory in New York, which is a little different than what was suggested over here.
Let me share with you a project that has yet to come to fruition, but that involves Meryl Euclides, who is the artist in residence with the New York City Department of Sanitation and has had that title since the late 1970s or early 1980s. Meryl is, I think, a revolutionary genius artist. She's also a friend and a mentor. Freshkills, after it was closed in 2001, it's now going through the post-closure process that will turn it into part of the largest park system in the city and is the most ambitious park project in the last century and a half. Meryl is the artist who is written into the contract of Freshkills' next iteration as the resident artist to make sure to imbue the final design with elements that only her unique perspective can bring. And one of her ideas is to ask people, she wants a million things. And she wants New Yorkers, well, there are 8.4 million of us at last count. So a million, that's not so many, right? So she wants a million things, small, that will be encased in a cube on which there will be a barcode. And when you scan the barcode, up will come the donor, the date, a story about it, the object, why. It should be something meaningful. And it will be placed throughout Freshkills as people use it, not as a garbage repository anymore, but as people recreate. And when they come across the cube, they can scan it and learn about who contributed it and what it meant to that person. That's a ways off still, but it's a little bit, I mean, it has resonance with your idea. You're on a good track. I mean, if Merrill Euclides thought of something similar, that's a really good track you're on. Anything else? You all are long-standing patient people or long-sitting patient people.
Robin, if I could leap in here. So I actually want to return to something that John brought up. The compacting. And I know this sounds really ugly, but it's actually, I think there's maybe another way we could think about this. In fact, John's idea brought up for me a book I read many years ago, and if I'm remembering it right, I'll be really glad. If I'm not, then whatever. Okay. Living Parallel. It's this Czech book by, I think the author's name was Alexander Clement. He was from Prague. A friend of mine who had just taken a trip brought it back and said I would love it, and I did. And it's about a guy who is charged with getting rid of books, of throwing away books, right? And he takes his job, you know, deadly seriously. He actually puts together these very intentional compactors full of books, and he organizes them, you know, painstakingly, and then crushes them. But, you know, he does this with all kinds of care. And there's, and in fact, in the end, of course, he actually, not of course, but he actually crushes himself with the books. It's like the end of the book. A painful ending. But what's really attractive about it, actually, is that he is so attentive to what he is crushing into a mass. And it kind of, it flips things around for us where we often, as you say, throw things away and forget. If we're so aware then of what we're compacting and throwing away, then it, doesn't it do something for us? I mean, we know now what all of this is, and it started in the trash, and now it's, I mean, it would be sort of symbolically interesting, and I realize it's challenging, but I'm wondering what you think about that, and if we understand it in those terms.
Two reactions. First, how will your great-grandchild know what that is? That compacted collection of carefully organized destruction. So that's question one. I don't know the stories of the things in Nelson's collection. One of the things that's occurred to me as we've been talking is the missing stories are part of the haunt. Same with Dead Horse Bay, when you see the shoes and the china and the nail polish. The other reaction I have is, it goes back to what I said before, that everything is future trash, right? So in a sense, in pulling Nelson's collection out of a garage and giving it a next home and giving it the proper sort of care and attention that I would like to see it have, we're merely delaying the inevitable. He pulled it out of its journey to its next phase in life and has given it a reprieve. But it will still be garbage someday in some form or other. And how long in the future? Who knows? It could be tomorrow. It could be in 1,000 years. But yes, the compaction and the, like, a part of me is like, let's just get it over with. Let's just get rid of it. It's going to happen. Just do it now. But that's a very dangerous way to think, because if you take that forward, what's the point of getting up in the morning? What's the point of any creative endeavor? Because it's all going to be for naught at some horrible, nihilistic, very dark kind of imagination. But you can't, I mean, now I'm talking myself into a little cul-de-sac, and I don't want to do that. I get you, and I understand, and I don't think you're wrong, and I don't think you're wrong either, John. I just don't want to do it yet. Have any of you read a novel called Rainbow's End by Werner Vinge? I was talking about this with Jim in the car this morning. There's a project to digitize the library at UC Berkeley, and the company that they hire to do it takes every book and shreds it into tiny, tiny, tiny sort of dust-sized particles and then throws it through this ocular reader that then reassembles it digitally as it had been originally. And just reading it is, I mean, there are protests and people don't want it to happen, but it's inevitable. And just reading that account of this sci-fi horror future of digitizing and undoing the materiality of the books is... It's hard to read, but he, I bet, would like your idea too. You, yes.
Yeah, it feels a little weird saying this idea now after you talked about that. But you, like, if pragmatically you have to save space and crushing things in like a meticulous organization is something that would be beneficial, you could combine that with the idea of having a million things, each with a story. But the problem, like you said, is that a lot of these things don't have stories, and just looking at them kind of brings stories to your own mind. So what if you crushed these cubes and then made a scanner with a picture, and like you'd scan it with your phone, and then you'd look at it and it'd show a picture of the original item. And if it doesn't have its own story, somebody could make up a story for it and put that in there. Because even your description of the star made from the beam, just like, in my mind, I was like, yeah, why would somebody throw that away? And then I immediately started creating this own story. And it'd be really like a collaborative project, because to make this something that would really last and really get people interested, you'd have to make it like multifaceted. And part of that could be like, write your story for this object, and then you'd also save space and stuff. So combine art and crush.
There was a project out of Pratt in Brooklyn. And they did something very like that, not with a collection on the scale of Nelson's and not with, I mean, it was a modest size by necessity. Max Liberon, who's coming next, she also, she's a scholar, an academic, a STEM science, I'm going to call her a scientist. I don't know if she would embrace that herself. She's also an artist, a very gifted and creative artist. And one of the works she did was an object kind of exchange that included stories. And I could see that as part of what Nelson has. The challenge with Nelson's collection is it's so big when considered from the scale of an individual human being, right? And then the logistical counterpart is, well, all the questions we've already bounced around. But the story idea, that's lovely. that Star of David has a whole new story now. In fact, everything in the collection now has a new story, even if we never know the old story. Did you have your hand up? Wait. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead. I didn't see.
It wasn't a question. I love the idea of it staying as one entire collection and having people create stories from it, because if you compact it into one massive, like, cube, you just have a list of objects with stories that people have created, but you don't get the same idea as being able to see it. Like, if you go to Ellis Island and you see, like, an old sweatshirt or a t-shirt from someone, there's no story behind it, but you can still look at the object, and, like, having a picture of it isn't the same as being able to walk up to it and seeing the ridges or the rust spots or the stains and wondering what happened to it.
I concur. There is something about the thingness of things that can't be replaced by a representation of the thing.
I think for me, that's the point. Like, that loss that you can't touch it and you can't recover those stories. Like, it's sitting in there, it's in front of you. But the point is that regardless of if you can see it or not, it's gone. And that sense of loss, like the throwing it away, is still there. And the story is in there, and everybody that it's important to, it's still in them. But for me, I think that's the beauty in that compacting. And I, like, got silly butterflies when he said that, because that's the point. Like, you do compact it and you lose a lot, and that's the point.
This is fascinating. This is, okay. Maybe we're imagining the cube differently. I'm imagining it's compacted into dust, and then you make a cube. Like, you're thinking of objects glommed together, but so you'd see what's on the surface, but you wouldn't see what's inside. You couldn't see what's in the middle. Your comment about loss, though, I think points back to, and I hadn't thought of this before, if Annette Wiener can talk about inalienability being, I'm giving something away, but there is not loss connected to it because it is affiliated with and a part of me and my heritage and my history and my being unto perpetuity. One of the reasons that the Molina Collection moves people so much, I believe, is that their own experience of loss, which is, life is shot through with it, all of us, all the time, right? In big and small ways. It's walking the collection both reminds you of particular instances of loss in your own life and also eases, I think, a little bit experiences of loss in your, like the pain of experiences of some forms of loss in your own life. And that's, I think, part of the emotional strength of it. Maybe it would do the same thing as a cube. Or maybe we have an entirely different resonance as a cube that is also marvelous. Maybe some of us, we keep some, and some of you cube it, and we have, that's the compromise. And we choose randomly. So that there's, yeah. So it's equally unlike, sort of equally eclectic on both sides.
Let me think about this. Hang on. I forgot how I was going to word it. If you were to make this collection into a museum, how much of it would you want people to be thinking about the past and loss and things like that, and to have people thinking about the future and change? Because I feel like if I were to visit that place, I would be sad. I would think about all the things that I've lost, and then I would continue on with my day, with my habits, with throwing things away. And my idea, like what I was thinking when you had the cube, imagine a long winding hallway full of all these pictures of things that people have discarded individually. And you turn the corner, and it's this massive cube of junk. You still get the individual stories. You still see, through the pictures, but you still see these individual things that people have discarded. And then you turn around, you see where all of it goes, where all of it ends up, you know? Because most of the stuff, all the things that he didn't pull out, are going to end up like that in a cube. So I feel like, you know.
Even worse, because the stuff that he didn't pull out, all household waste from Manhattan goes to an incinerator. So it isn't even going to be a cube or a landfill. It's just going to be ashes. This is fascinating. This points to, I think, a profoundly important element of our understanding of in relationship to material culture, and a kind of a divide between those of us who want to hold it, whatever is the it, And those of us who are content to have a representation of the it have a different form of a photograph and a story and a sculptural kind of conglomeration that would also have an emotional impact different from the walking the junk. In terms of what I want people to get out of a museum, if Nelson's collection were understood to be like any museum, to do a museum exhibition or a museum institution, there has to be a story underneath it that justifies, not justifies, but explains to the world why does this exist? Why does it matter? Why did someone go to the trouble to put this in the world? And what does it bring to my life to encounter and experience that museum? I don't have a predetermined idea that if you come to New York and walk the collection, here's what I want you to get from it. The reactions people have are so different. The narrative that I would write is about Nelson himself, about the neighborhood, about the mission of sanitation, and about these themes that we've been discussing tonight about loss and about time and about how an object is defined one way and then a different way and what's the force that changes that definition. But in terms of what you take away from it, I would love to hear you tell me what did you take away from it. And it could be that you come to New York and walk the collection and you're done and you're like, yeah, cubic. And that, you know, that's, there's no right or wrong way to encounter this. I'm thinking of a survey to figure out if people would rather, I don't know, the questions and the comments and the ideas that have come up tonight have radically opened my thinking about this project. And it's better than I had hoped for. And I knew it would be good, but it's even better than I had hoped for. I don't know how we're doing on time. There are two hands over here. Yeah.
Should we take two more questions?
Okay. I do want to, I have some great Dead Horse Bay pictures, but now.
I had this idea because of what Dr. Crane was saying about this book where he compacted things multiple times. Myself, I'm actually like nostalgic and sentimental to a fault. Like, I really don't like throwing things away. But it was making me think about, instead of like taking the entire collection and putting it into a gigantic cube, first of all, a lot of things wouldn't cube very well. I think stuffed animals and like electronics wouldn't really do the trick. But for the things that would work, maybe you could make a smaller series of cubes. If compaction was really the only way to save the collection.
It's not. We haven't determined that yet. Just.
But if it were, hypothetically, maybe you could have a larger amount of smaller cubes where the items within were actually more distinct and differentiable, and you could actually see things arranged by category. And to get just a little bit ambitious and futuristic, the idea of actual like cooperation with this hospital that's going to be taking this place, you could take a cube and put it through like an MRI scanner and have the inside of it mapped out, and then you could have an interface where people could look at the actual cube itself and then explode it in a mechanical sense and see the objects that were inside. So if you had unlimited resources.
And if the hospital liked sanitation.
Right.
There's a little tension between the two institutions about space, as a matter of fact.
All this cube talk makes me think of the movie Wall-E, actually.
Wall-E four times. I love
it. Yeah. And interestingly enough, for that robot, what gives him his soul is the individual objects, but also the fact that the individual objects don't have their stories, like, out in the open. He is interacting with these objects. And in a way, he's sort of assigning stories to these objects.
Wait, he's just doing his job. He's just making cubes. What stories are you?
But he plucks out the objects. He plucks out
special objects. He has a pretty good Mongo collection.
He makes cubes, but he also picks out objects that matter to him.
Yeah, you're right.
So I think that the whole cube thing kind of takes out the agency of the person who would be walking the collection.
So is that good or bad? Are you advocating that, or you're just?
I am not advocating the cubes. Okay. I do not like the cubes.
We have the. We should. We can like arrange the seating here with the pro cubes and the anti cubes. Hey, there's a band name in there somewhere.
Can we have one more person maybe who has a question or comment or something that they want to say to Robin who hasn't spoken yet? And then we'll wrap up. Great.
I just wanted to ask if this is not about the cubes or anything. If you thought, I don't know, about donating the objects that are usable, that people in need might have use for, or having it be like some type of free store that people come and take what they want?
Yes and no. That's the free store idea was not bounced around yet, but the donating idea was. That's not off the table. It just hasn't been weighed yet. It just hasn't been given full attention. Let me just add one more note about the cubes. May I remind you, the Borg? Do I have to say, come on. Do I have to say anything more about cubes, really? Okay, that's all.
Thanks so much, Robin.